Welcome, everyone, to the University of Miami's 2011 Global Business Forum. I'm Barbara Kahn. I'm the Dean of the University School of Business Administration, and I'm your conference host. I'm delighted to see so many of you here in this auditorium today. I want to begin by encouraging those of you who are tweeting from the conference or will be following the global conversation through social networking to always use the hashtag symbol, hashtag GBF2011. We have a great opportunity to share what's happening here with the world, so let's do it. It's again, hashtag GBF2011. When we started planning this conference, our second global business forum, we set out to focus once again on a timely global issue that touches each and every one of us, every organization, large and small. The business of healthcare, the theme of this year's conference, was then and is today the clear choice. The ramifications of healthcare reform are immense, and the debate over solutions has never been more intense as they are today, reading in today's headlines. I can't think of a better time than right now with what we have seen over the past year, and as we look forward in 2011 to focus on the issues that we will address over the next 2 days. Everything from the economic issues related to healthcare and healthcare reform, to innovative medical technologies, to wellness and prevention, aging, the environment, education, hospital design, healthcare delivery, and so much more. I also can't think of a better place to have deep discussion on these critical and timely issues than here at the University of Miami. Because of our unique structure, this is a place where innovative thinking flourishes, a place where we can innovate and transform education and research to better meet the demands of the 21st century global economy. Although the Global Business Forum was hatched at the School of Business, the program we have developed is truly cross-disciplinary. We are involving the schools of architecture, communication, education, law, medicine, music, marine and atmospheric science, nursing and health studies, and the colleges of engineering and arts and sciences. We're also participating as the Arnold Center for Confluence Studies, the Launchpad, and Lowell Art Museum. Of course, helping making all of this possible is our inspirational leader and president, President Shalala, who you will hear from in a moment. But before we begin, I want to acknowledge our Board of Trustees members that are here today. Pat Barron and David Epstein are here in the audience. I also want to mention and thank our key sponsors, Blue Cross and Blue Shield of Florida, and Bank of America Merrill Lynch, both of which have been with us since our first global forum in 2009. Also, our signature sponsor, Quest Diagnostics, and our plenary sponsors, the University of Miami Health System, Baptist Health South Florida, which we are very pleased to introduce as the sponsor of the opening keynote session. A special note of gratitude also to VITAS, a panel session and scholarship sponsor, which has provided us with support to provide scholarships to 65 students to attend the Global Forum at no cost. These students are in the audience today, thank you, and I hope you'll have a chance to talk with them. Our students are phenomenal. So again, thanks to all of you and to our many corporate and media sponsors who have made this event possible. I also want to thank our incredible lineup of keynote speakers and our nearly 150 panelists for participating in this very special program. There is one change not reflected in your program I would like to note. Unfortunately, Tom Ryan, the chairman and CEO of CVS Caremark, will not be able to join us for a closing keynote session. However, Troy Brennan, who's the firm's vice president and chief medical officer, will be here on Friday, so we are delighted to welcome him in Tom's place. And now, it gives me great pleasure to introduce Penny Schaefer, South Florida's market president for Blue Cross and Blue Shield of Florida, one of our key sponsors. Penny was one of the first local business leaders I met when I came to Miami as the dean of business school more than 3 years ago. She had the vision to help us bring our school to have a reputation as one of the truly great business schools. Establishing the Global Business Forum was a key part of that vision, and Penny got it. A true visionary, Penny understood what we needed to do and how we could make it happen. In her position, Penny is responsible for Blue Cross Blue Shield of Florida's business operations across South Florida. Throughout her career, she has held leadership positions with various charitable and professional organizations, which I'm pleased to say includes our own advisory board here at the School of Business. Penny has been an incredible supporter of the school, and she is a great friend. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming Penny Schaefer.
Good morning. Thank you, Dean Kahn. It's my pleasure to welcome you to the conference. And for those of you who are lamenting the cold this morning here, let me report, according to the Weather Channel, we are the only state in the United States that has no snow today, including Hawaii. Yes. When Dean Kahn arrived in Miami, she very quickly set forth a vision for the role the business school would play in the future of all things related to health management. This global business forum was a part of that vision and now will be a living legacy. The vision was embraced across the university and is shared across the many disciplines. You will note the multidisciplinary approach in the delivery of the forum content, from the business school to the medical school, from nursing to education, to communication, to architecture, and even art and music. I was quickly convinced of the importance of that vision to the Miami community and to our company. Blue Cross Blue Shield is a not-for-profit independent licensee of the Blue Cross Blue Shield brand. This dynamic forum is right in line with our mission to advance the health and well-being of Florida citizens, not only by meeting customer needs, but also through a much greater commitment to the public good. We're committed to helping people and communities achieve better health, and we've brought some of our innovative energies to bear on addressing the complexities of navigating the healthcare system. Our Florida Blue retail centers are dedicated to educating the community, members or not, on how to shop well, choose well, and live well. We also have entered into a unique public-private partnership right here in Miami-Dade County to bring a comprehensive, affordable product, Miami-Dade Blue, to the market of more than 600,000 uninsured residents here. We've put comparison shopping tools literally in the hands of the community with our unique Get Blue on the Go mobile website. And as a health plan leader serving about 4 million Floridians, we welcome the opportunity to foster innovation and excellence in healthcare through the great meeting of these minds. Today's keynote speakers have long and distinguished careers in public service. They share a passion for improving the quality of life in America and have championed greater access to affordable, high-quality health care for everyone. They've each worn the hat of the country's highest-ranking health official as Secretary of the Department of Health and Human Services. And if there is one government agency that best represents a multidisciplinary approach to government, it is the HHS. Its 80,000 employees help manage everything from food safety and fraud prevention to early learning and insurance programs for the elderly, disabled, and poor. As the country addresses health care reform, perhaps no one has a better and more nuanced perspective than our first speaker. Donna Shalala has been professor of political science and president of the University of Miami since 2001. She's an accomplished scholar, teacher, administrator, and highly decorated public servant. In 1993, President Bill Clinton appointed her as the 18th Secretary of Health and Human Services, where she served until 2001, becoming the longest serving HHS Secretary in US history. President Shalala is a recognized expert in health policy and was selected by President George W. Bush to co-chair with Senator Robert Dole the Commission on Care for Returning Wounded Warriors. And she chairs the Institute of Medicine Commission on the Future of Nursing, which recently released a report stressing the need for nurses to play a greater role, both as caregivers and leaders, in order for healthcare reform to succeed. Please welcome President Donna Shalala.
Thank you very much, Penny, and thank you to all of our sponsors. When President Obama nominated Kathleen Sebelius to be his Secretary of Health and Human Services in 2009, he was nominating the 21st Secretary of Health and Human Services. And he intended to send Congress, and he did, a clear message that the push for healthcare reform would be thoughtful, disciplined, and transparent. because that's everyone's description of Kathleen Sebelius. As a state legislator, as an insurance commissioner, and as governor of the state of Kansas, Secretary Sebelius has firsthand experience in winning bipartisan support for key legislative issues and in streamlining unwieldy budgets. She is the daughter of a governor, and since we're both from Ohio, I should point out that her father, Jack Gilligan, was the governor of Ohio and the first governor I remember as a child, and a great governor and legislator, because he was actually in Congress, if I remember correctly, when Medicare was passed. Secretary Sebelius is a very good listener and a very skilled negotiator, exactly what's needed to go toe-to-toe with Congress these days. Her first challenge was to step in and coordinate the department's response to the potentially disruptive H1N1 flu pandemic. And before you could say Tamiflu, President Obama tasked her with reforming the nation's healthcare system. I had the pleasure of working with the secretary early in the Clinton administration on a commission on patient safety and a patient bill of rights, and she was extraordinary. And during that time, I actually remember taking her over to the White House to introduce her to a young budget director who became important in both that relationship and later as she assumed the duties as secretary, Nancy Ann Mindeparl, who is, of course, the head of the White House Office of Health Reform. And I hope it actually was helpful, because there's nothing more complicated than a cabinet officer's relationship with the White House. Please welcome a very distinguished public servant and a world-class leader, Secretary Kathleen Sebelius.
Well, good morning. I have to tell you, those of you in Miami who are whining about the weather, it's minus 2 degrees this morning in Kansas City, and it's 24 degrees in Washington, D.C., so this is balmy. Feels pretty good. Before I begin my remarks today, I do want to start with just an acknowledgement of the horrific shooting that occurred in Arizona over the weekend, and remind everyone of the president's call that we engage in public discourse in a more civil fashion, in large part to honor those whose lives have been lost and to work together on the enormous challenges facing this country, one of which is the topic of this forum for the next few days. I think one of the unseen or untalked about stories of the weekend was to see an absolutely first-class health system at work with the kind of trauma care that was delivered. And I know the University of Miami is also famous for the trauma care center, but Americans got up close and personal with the kind of excellent health care that exists in areas of the country, and hopefully that will help us with a clear understanding of the kind of care everyone should get each and every day. I want to thank President Shalala not only for her kind introduction, but for her incredible service. I live in Shalala Land at HHS. You're going to hear later in the program from our wonderful FDA Commissioner Peggy Hamburg, who is here, who was part of the team that Secretary Shalala put together over and over again. I am working with and have the privilege to have as colleagues these incredibly smart, dedicated, talented folks, many of whom came together to work on the mission of health and human services under the leadership of Donna Shalala. So I'm grateful each and every day. Donna's also left an extraordinary legacy. And, you know, I'm reminded, whether it's working to strengthen our defenses against bioterrorism or the battles that we have against infectious diseases or securing Medicare for future generations, everything that we're doing in that department is built on a foundation that Donna has laid. So I think it's extraordinary that, again, she could have done anything as she left the department, but chose to continue her career of service at this great university. And it's to your great good fortune. And I know that the students and faculty and community feel fortunate that she decided, like another famous transplant, to take her talents to South Beach. So when President Shalala told me that the theme of the forum was defining the future of healthcare, I was eager to take part in this because I think the future looks brighter right now than it has in decades. In the last 2 years, Congress has passed more important health legislation than at any time since the passage of Medicare. And as the President already told you, my father actually was on the Energy and Commerce Committee and helped to write the Medicare bill. He will be 90 in March, and he now is a pleased beneficiary of those services. The focus of a lot of the conversation is always on the Affordable Care Act, the law that the President signed in March of 2010. But what we failed to realize is the extraordinary investment in health and improvements in health made prior to that legislation that really set the platform. So Congress in the last 2 years has passed historic laws to expand health insurance for children, an expansion of the CHIP legislation that when as secretary, Secretary Shalala was enormously involved in launching, to reduce and regulate the use of tobacco, an area that Dr. Hamburg is now overseeing, to jumpstart the adoption of electronic medical records, to invest for the first time nationally in the promotion of healthier lifestyles, make extraordinary investments in the healthcare workforce, again, an area which is continuing to be in the forefront of what Donna Shalala is working on, made the single largest increase in scientific research in 1 year ever in the history of this country. We've begun a nationwide doubling of the footprint of community health centers and provided critical new resources to the Indian Health Center. That was all done before the Affordable Care Act was actually passed and signed into law. We've also seen some extraordinary partnerships coming together, and I know it's not easy to see that if you're just watching cable TV 24/7, but there is a lot of collaboration and agreement on moving in a new direction, and I think the fact that this is a global business forum is very fitting to talk about healthcare because we've seen some unprecedented support in the business community, among healthcare providers, in academia around building a different platform for the health system. We actually had involved in the discussion around the Affordable Care Act organizations that had long opposed any kind of health reform, helping to lead the charge toward a new day. And part of the reason is that the bill actually incorporates many of the best ideas for improving quality and lowering costs from employers and health systems around the country. So there is now a lot of momentum, and I don't think it's surprising when you consider the alternative of doing nothing and what the status quo actually looks like. Now, despite having the world's finest doctors, the best hospitals, the most advanced health technologies in the world, America continues to lag behind in health results. We know that a portion of the problem is lifestyle. We have too many Americans who don't eat a healthy diet and don't get enough exercise, too many people who still smoke, even though the latest research just released weeks ago show that even a single cigarette can be very dangerous. And we know that the problems with the system don't stop when Americans walk into a hospital or engage in a doctor's office. We still have a snapshot that more patients die every year from the infections they get in hospitals than from car accidents and homicides combined. And according to a recent report, 1 out of 7 Medicare beneficiaries who go to the hospital is harmed as a result of the care they receive, not the illness they have. So what that means for Americans is pretty simple. Unfortunately, we live sicker and die younger than we should. We have more pain and discomfort and less ability to do our jobs, to volunteer in our neighborhoods, to play with our children. Too few of us get to watch our grandchildren grow up. And bad health has huge costs for the economy also. According to a recent estimate, poor quality care leads to as many as 45 million avoidable sick days, the equivalent of 180,000 full-time employees calling in sick for a full year. At the same time, the skyrocketing costs of care put enormous burden on families, state and federal budgets, and companies' balance sheets, and puts America's businesses at a severe disadvantage in our global economy. Last year, I think Warren Buffett summed it up pretty well. He said, rising healthcare costs are the tapeworm eating at America's competitiveness. So when you look at the big picture of our healthcare system, the challenges we face may seem insurmountable. And yet we know there are some very bright snapshots of success across the country. And over the last 2 years, I've visited neighborhoods that are working on improving health by serving healthier school lunches, met with creative employers who are bringing down health costs with on-site clinics, and toured hospitals showing how it's possible to dramatically improve patient outcomes. When our department recently hosted a national summit on healthcare quality and value, we drew leaders from across the country who have cut costs, slashed readmission rates, improved coordination between providers, and in one case, gone a full year without any errors. Now, we know a better healthcare system is possible because it exists. Now it's just scattered in pockets of excellence across the country. And the problem is that these best practices have been very slow to spread. In Michigan, when a coalition of hospitals was able to cut central line infections by 2/3, reduce healthcare costs by over $200 million, and save 1,500 lives in 18 months by using the checklist developed by Johns Hopkins, we would have thought that that system would have been immediately picked up in hospitals across the country. Unfortunately, that has not happened. But that's where I think we in the government can be extraordinarily helpful. Government for too long has actually lagged behind the private sector as a leader in promoting quality in healthcare. And yet there's no doubt that we have an unparalleled ability to accelerate change, whether it's by sharing best practices, making targeted investments, or creating financial incentives through the purchasing power of Medicare and Medicaid. Now, it's only when Medicare stopped paying for the so-called never events, for example, the medical errors that should never happen, that other payers also stopped paying, and that the never events actually dropped pretty dramatically. When government puts its support behind best practice efforts, improvements in healthcare can speed up dramatically. And that's exactly what we're trying to do over the last 2 years. It started really with investments in the Recovery Act, and we identified some of the most promising local strategies in the country for reducing obesity and tobacco use. And they range from bringing farmers markets to underserved communities to expanding access to trails and bike paths and parks so people can have safe and secure places to exercise. Communities receive grants, and we're following up very carefully to measure the results. Eventually, we hope grantees with the best outcomes will become models for the rest of the country. So if you're a mayor or a school superintendent or a state health commissioner and want to know, how do I get more people to quit smoking? How do I reduce the obesity rates in our community? We'll be able to shine a light on practices that are effective strategies and that we know work. Under the new health care law, we're also helping the private sector to promote better health. Now, private employers have been way ahead, have often been leaders in setting up wellness programs to help workers stay healthy and out of the hospital. And now the Affordable Care Act gives them an additional boost, increases the worker rewards up to 30% of the cost of health coverage for participating in wellness programs and meeting health benchmarks, which we know is a strategy with proven success. It gives those business owners a little extra incentive to invest in a healthy workforce. Good for them, good for their company's productivity, and certainly good for the nation. The new law also directly addresses some of the obstacles that keep Americans from staying healthy. For example, we're training and supporting new primary care doctors and nurse practitioners to address the shortage of primary care practitioners experienced by way too many Americans. Because too many people still come through the doors of emergency rooms with costly conditions that could have been treated more effectively and more strategically if they'd been caught early. So the bill has worked to eliminate co-pays for preventive care like mammograms and vaccines to take down the financial barriers that still may preclude people from getting access to preventive care. And whether you're a city council member or a human resources vice president or parent or student, the legislation signed by the president makes it easier for you to do more to keep the people around you healthy, whether it's your neighbors, your workers, your family, or your children. And still, no matter how successful we are at promoting healthier lifestyles, Americans are still going to get sick or injured. And when they do, the goal is to get the right care to the right patient at the right time. And again, there are great models of how to do this. Across the country and right here in Miami, there are practices and hospitals where patients consistently get the right care at the right time. And yet, far too many Americans who turn to our healthcare system to get better continue to get care that actually makes their healthcare problems worse. So we've asked, what can we do to help effective models of care spread? And a lot of those answers went right into the healthcare law. One of the consistent challenges that healthcare providers face is that they often don't get rewarded for doing the right thing. And in many cases, one could argue they get financially penalized. For example, we know that one of five Medicare patients is back in the hospital within 30 days of being discharged, and many times has not seen a healthcare provider in that intervening period of time. Now, some of those readmissions are clearly medically related and unavoidable. But often, when no one checks up on the patient released, nobody follows up to make sure they've filled their prescription or taking the medication or monitoring warning signs, getting the right wound care, they end up with a readmission. And today, the financial incentives actually reward, if you will, those readmissions. Hospitals who are paid per bed per day end up being the beneficiaries of what turns out to be a revolving door, and hospitals doing the best work on keeping patients well after their hospital release are often penalized. So as part of the new law, we're working on strategies like bundled care payments to reward coordination of care not only within the hospital but upon release. We know it works. Hospitals in Denver and Philadelphia have reduced readmissions and targeted cases by over 30%. And with that effort, we hope to be able to replicate those practices across the country. Another promising approach is the medical home model. And in practices that involve a medical home, patients get care in the community from a team, doctors, nurses, social workers, often community health workers, who coordinate care strategies to cut down on unnecessary treatments and work closely with patients to make sure they're managing their chronic conditions. Now, in several states across the country, we've already seen this model of care: lower costs from chronic disease, lower costs from emergency room visits and hospital stays, increase access to important preventive care, and dramatically improve patient satisfaction. But again, there are barriers to doctors and nurses practicing this way because the current system pays per procedure and per appointment, and for the treatments that their patients receive, and not necessarily for keeping them healthy in the first place. So Medicare is launching a new initiative, joining with Medicaid and private insurers to support as many as 1,200 medical homes in states across the country. We want to allow a lot more practices to adopt this model and allow doctors to focus on what they do best, actually keeping people healthy in the first place. A third place that we're helping health innovation spread across the country is electronic health records. Over the last few decades, we've seen industry after industry use information technology to bring down costs and improve customer service. Imagine just for a moment, those of you who are old enough to do this, like I am, go back to the day where you had to write a check for every payment that you made. You had to wait until the bank opened to actually get cash. We couldn't imagine going back to that day, and yet, unfortunately, the healthcare industry is still really in a papered system. Now, electronic medical records not only shift important data onto a computer, but actually really can help drive best practice protocol and coordinate care. And I've seen firsthand the incredible difference integrated electronic health records can make. I visited a neonatal ward at Cincinnati Children's Hospital not too long ago, and they're doing some of the most complicated surgeries on infants and around the world. They have gone 1,000 days without a serious safety incident, a record that they directly credit to the use of technology dealing with those patients and parents in this hospital. And when this administration came to office, just 2 in 10 doctors, 20% of doctors, and 10% of hospitals used any kind of an integrated electronic health record. Through the investments and platforms set in the Recovery Act, we're working to eliminate the obstacles that are stopping other health systems from doing what they're doing in Cincinnati. We're funding regional extension centers where doctors from small practices and critical care hospitals who don't have elaborate IT departments can get hands-on advice about how to set up and how to use the technology. We're investing in a health IT workforce so providers can find trained workers to run their system. And starting this month, we're providing financial incentives to doctors and hospitals who use electronic health records to improve patient care. Later today, actually, we're announcing the application process for the payments and the new survey data showing that more than 4 out of 5 hospitals and more than 2 of 5 doctors immediately plan to take advantage of those payments and begin to shift their practices into a technological age. So we're trying to take down the barriers, provide incentives, and now America's doctors and hospitals are embracing a technology that will not only help them do their jobs better, but we know can dramatically reduce safety incidents and improve the care of millions of Americans. This is the kind of change that we see across our healthcare system when the weight of the federal government is applied to the best ideas on how to improve health. And that's one of the reasons I believe the future of healthcare is very bright. As a nation, there's no more important goal to our prosperity than to be a healthy country. Health is the foundation of our competitiveness. Healthy adults are more prosperous workers. Healthy children are better students. Healthy families can make a bigger contribution to their communities. So the historic legislation of the last 2 years, including the Affordable Care Act, which once and for all will give every American the opportunity to have access to affordable health coverage, gives us a huge opportunity to improve the health of our nation, bringing benefits to every area of our lives. So again, I'm pleased to have a chance to be with you today. I appreciate the dialogue that's going to occur over the next couple of days. I look forward to learning from President Shalala about the new ideas and newest strategies that we should be implementing at the Department of Health and Human Services. We know that the experts you will hear from the healthcare community, from the business community, from providers and academia, are the leaders of the future. We have an historic moment. We have a great opportunity, and working together, we can have a healthier nation. Thank you all very much.
Thank you very much, Secretary Sebelius, for those inspiring words. And we have time for one or two questions. If someone wants to come up to the microphone to ask a question of the Secretary.
Start off. Secretary, you mentioned that you believe that America is, you know, very advanced technologically, yet it lags globally. What do you think America can do and to remain globally competitive in the healthcare field?
Well, I think we've got lots of opportunities. Clearly, we are at the leading edge of scientific research, and I think the investment in the research that NIH is currently doing is a huge boost to that. But we have to make sure that even in these very difficult budget times, we don't lose our cutting edge in the research community. You'll probably hear this from Dr. Hamburg. I don't want to steal her thunder, but there's some very exciting work going on in regulatory science, making sure that the scientists at NIH who are, you know, on the cutting edge of the microscope also are working very closely with the scientists at the Food and Drug Administration to make sure that promising ideas get from microscope to marketplace in a timely, seamless, and more accelerated fashion. And that, I think, is critical. We have an opportunity to actually be a leader in electronic health records. What I've learned from health ministers across the world, who I meet with on a regular basis, that although in many countries there are areas where there's a denser employment of electronic health records, no one has tried to, again, do what we are doing, which is to bring to scale nationally an entire system where we would be able to use electronic health records, not only to deliver better patient-centered care, but actually to share information. It will be a huge advancement for research and scientists, and the opportunity to be interoperable not only across a state, but across a country, and eventually across the globe. We've just signed a MOU with the European Union to make sure that our technology strategies will be interoperable internationally is a huge advancement. And if America can get to the forefront of that, that's another leadership role. We train health workers all over the world. You know, as President Shalala knows well, HHS work in countries, in developing countries, is often the soft diplomacy. We are welcomed in areas that really are not eager to see the State Department. They really don't want to have any military presence, but they are eager to have health workers. And everything from maternal and child health work to the PEPFAR strategies on HIV/AIDS are an area where we are clearly internationally connected. What a lot of my international colleagues find mystifying is how in the 21st century we could still be in this country debating whether or not all of our citizens should have access to health care. That they find to be remarkable. And frankly, the enthusiasm about the signing of the Affordable Care Act is much more palpable internationally than sometimes it's it is nationally. But I think we do have an opportunity with a simultaneous investment in health and wellness, and also access to affordable care for all of our citizens, expansion of the opportunity to come into the system, a real chance to close our dramatic health disparities, but also to produce a healthier workforce. You know, employers have spent billions of dollars trying to deal with health costs and strategies. Our willingness to join with them to look at the best efforts in patient safety and patient care to reduce some of the underlying costs, to invest in the strategies that we know work, and to really shift a system from an acute care system to a health and wellness system can be one of the most effective ways to make America competitive in this global economy, because employers are now selling cars, and you know, you'll hear from Jeff Immelt later in this program about the products that GE markets around the world. But layered on top of each of those products is a healthcare cost. And if we can bring those costs down and again spread that opportunity, I think it makes our companies and our country far more competitive in the future.
Thank you very much. I think we have to end now, or President Shalal, I see you.
No, let me ask the question.
We'll have her ask
you
one question.
One who is always shy about questions.
You've had a lot of experience in bipartisan settings. The politics has changed in Washington. Do you have the resources to do the implementation? There's going to be a symbolic vote to repeal health care reform. How do you wend your way through that and get healthcare reform implemented?
Well, it's a great question. I'm in the process right now of meeting with some of the new leadership team in the House of Representatives, and clearly there is a pledged commitment that they want to repeal health reform, and I think that vote's likely to occur next week. The practical politics is that that effort doesn't go very far, because in order to repeal the bill, it has to be passed by the House, it has to be passed by the Senate, it has to be signed by the President. That is not likely to happen. So then we need to immediately go to where it is that we work together and how we work forward. There is a lot of talk and discussion about not only defunding healthcare, but frankly, also discussion that would be extraordinarily harmful about making dramatic across-the-board cuts in overall spending levels. And the kinds of efforts that are underway in scientific research, in health and wellness, in investing in our workforce, in issues that are critical to move the health system forward would be at the front end of taking the brunt of a lot of those cuts. So I think the effort will be to bring together citizens like those of you in the room today, employers, providers, experts from academia, to actually present the impact of what happens really if we keep the status quo. What are the alternatives to moving in a new direction, and what does that look like? And certainly going back to where we were, capturing that snapshot and bringing into the discussion the American people, who are beginning to, even in these early days, the health bill was signed 9 months ago, and what I find as I travel is that people are beginning to connect with some of the benefits. So parents now know when their student graduates from a great university like the University of Miami, they can keep their child on a family health plan if indeed that young adult is not going into a job that has health benefits. Our sons, one son went off to law school, the other son, I'm still not quite sure what he did, but let's just say it didn't have health insurance, okay? So I know as a parent, what that was like. I mean, we have parents of children with pre-existing conditions who, for the first time, feel that they don't have to worry each and every day if they lose their job or quit their job or what's going to happen when their kid ages out of their plan. They can get health insurance and security. Seniors are beginning to understand some of the new benefits that will actually strengthen Medicare, the annual wellness visit, the fact that there's no longer co-pays on preventive care. So as people begin to connect with the benefits, I think the conversation that members of Congress have to have is not with me and not with the president, it's with their constituents. You know, what is it that they replace that with? What is it that they put in place for the hundreds of thousands of their constituents who have no access to the health system at all? What do they say to great hospitals like here at Jackson, which I think the number is $750 million in uncompensated care last year, and the notion that that's a good system to run, where people wait until they're more acutely ill and enter through the emergency room of a hospital as opposed to getting preventive and health care at the front end, I think that we have an opportunity around this debate to really do some further education of people and to actually ask, what is the alternative? What is the strategy for moving ahead? And I think that in some ways can be a more productive conversation than it was when the bill was being drafted, because it was so intangible to many people. Now that there are some tangible benefits, I think that conversation is actually easier to indicate to people. Healthcare is very personal. Each of us has our own experience and our own story, and what we have the challenge to do is connecting people to the system in a way that they really understand how these changes and improvements can benefit them and their families. Again, thank you for having me.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Secretary Sebelius.